done. Getting some of the
probability theory.
You know, there'll be like one as well.
That seems to be, you know.
You said that you made.
Yeah, I'll try to this week. Probably not until you start doing it functionally.
Okay, I guess we should get started. Okay, so where are we? We're in the midst of trying to prove some things about Fourier transforms. And the thing that we, the two things that we still have to do, which we haven't finished from last time, are showing that on Schwartz functions, the inverse Fourier transform really is the inverse Fourier transform. And then we also want to know this fact that the Schwartz functions on Rn are dense. In particular, we need to know that they're dense in L2 functions on Rn. And so this is this final step where we're going to, after having studied what Fourier transform does on Schwartz functions, see that basically lets us do Fourier transforms on L2 just by extending the map from Schwartz to Schwartz to a map from L2 to L2. But we'll actually prove this for LQ because it's no more expensive. So I kind of got halfway through the proof of this last time, but it was sort of getting pretty messy. So I think we might just start from the top, and we'll go through the first steps reasonably quickly, and hopefully get there. So we're trying to compute this. And so let's write out. It's just expanding all the definitions. And then we use this trick of inserting into the integrand this mollifying factor that makes it easier to do the integration.
Some part of the equation is not appearing in the video.
Yeah. So I was just experimenting.
You can like draw lines.
No. Strangely, the video that it records is actually wider aspect ratio than what it shows you on the screen while you're recording. So I was just fiddling with it before, recording little videos and stopping it and looking at them again, and it really did go all the way up to there. Uh-huh. So if it doesn't, yell at me and we'll do it properly.
We're
but yeah.
Here, so it doesn't matter for us.
Yeah, no, thanks for pointing it out. I think that I'm doing it right. It's just an annoying feature that Apple doesn't actually show you what you're actually recording. Okay. And then we've still got this inner integral. And the point of this was that you can argue this just by the dominated convergence theorem. That function's converging pointwise up to the identity function 1, and otherwise these integrals are all fine. And the integrand is all L1, so you really can deduce a factor like that. Okay. And so then we use Fubini, so let's come back in a moment to just talk about how much justification is actually needed to do Fubini. But now we arrange to do the dy integral first, and the dxi integral on the inside, so we can rearrange the factors that appear here and put the ones that don't depend on xi at all out the front, and then we've got this integral over everything that involves xi, which ends up being that. Okay. So, already assuming this really is justified, this is sort of a great step. I mean, our job, of course, is to try and get the phi of y somehow all the way out the front. I mean, so we've made a bit of progress. So why does Fubini work here? Well, the whole integrand, all of these functions inside we're integrating, is Schwartz. You've got to be a little bit careful there. So obviously, like, this is Schwartz in with respect to the variable y by hypothesis. These guys don't matter so much because they're So this is Schwartz with respect to the variable xi, and this is Schwartz with respect to the variable y. And then, so I guess a little lemma is that sort of if f and g are Schwartz functions on Rn, f of x times g of y is Schwartz on out of the 2n. So like the exterior product of two Schwartz functions is Schwartz. And so that's how we're thinking about those two terms. And what are we doing thinking about this? We sort of just ignore that. I mean, this part is absolute value 1. So the point is the when you look at the product of all of these guys, it's up to some phase factor, a Schwartz function being the product of those two guys, and Schwartz functions in particular are L1, so the whole integrand is L1. Okay, so we're allowed to use Fubini and do that sort of thing. Okay, and then this thing is just the definition of the inverse Fourier transform. So we can just write this as G of e to the minus epsilon xi squared over 2. But we've got to be a little bit careful because that's not what you would usually see in the exponent there. I mean, usually you just see an x or something. The point is that this is the inverse Fourier transform evaluated at the point x minus y to plug that in. And then it's still the dy integral together. Okay, and now that's okay because Fourier transforms of Gaussian functions are easy enough. So we can basically, the point is we can just do that integral, and you get some annoying constant factors. And here, notice that in the exponent there, the epsilon used to be in the numerator and ended up in the denominator there. So maybe here are the little formulas. The Fourier transform of e to the minus ax squared over 2 is this. And then just applying inverse Fourier transform to those formulas, you can see that the inverse Fourier transform of something that looks like that okay, and so that's that formula there is what we're plugging in there, with, I guess, b equals 1 over epsilon. Okay, so that's great, we got to there. And now we do a change of variables. We let y equal x plus square root epsilon times some new variable z. So what's the point of doing that? Well, this basically lets us replace the whole exponent there in this exponential with something very simple. Okay? So that's the limit as epsilon goes to 0. I guess we could even cancel some stuff at this point. I must have got a sign wrong here. Because I wanted these to cancel a bit. Those two pi's to cancel rather than add up. Can you see what I've done wrong here?
That 2 pi epsilon to the minus that on 2, I'm not 100% sure where that, like, shouldn't that be 2 pi on epsilon, or?
So we're looking at this guy, we're trying to use this formula with b equals 1 over epsilon, because here epsilon's in the numerator and there it's in the denominator. So with b equals 1 over epsilon,
okay.
I think that looks right. That is a negative sign there, isn't it? Because that had the square root 1 over 2 pi epsilon. Does anyone see something that's going wrong with the two pi's?
So is it possibly because the negative starts on the second line down for the e to the minus epsilon? So is it there?
Yeah, I'm not so much worried about the epsilon. The epsilon part is actually going to work out. It's just the two pi's cancelling that.
Oh yeah, but if that epsilon is not negative, then your inverse Fourier transform won't give you on it.
Yeah, okay, well... So that's clearly... Well, we'll just keep going with it, but it's clearly wrong. I mean, that's not going to give us the right answer, if that's our experiment. Let's just see how everything else pans out. This becomes x plus square root epsilon z. And then, if you think about what dy is, so dy is actually going to be epsilon to the n over 2 dz, because remember, y and z are coordinates on Rn, so if you scale the coordinates by some factor, the measure scales by that factor to the nth power, so we're in n-dimensional space. So that part works great, because that epsilon is going to exactly kill that epsilon. And then we have e to the minus z squared over 2 dz. Yeah.
Sorry, I'm not completely wrong on this, because I could just go for x, but at least what you've done in the notes is that that's not a, it's not the inverse Fourier transform, it's just the Fourier transform, I think. I'm reading this right. But when you switch the order of integration, you don't get out the inverse one, you just get the Fourier transform. Which puts the 2 pi in the numerator.
Oh, it's just that I forgot to. Yeah, I mean, I just, this isn't the formula for the inverse Fourier transform.
That.
Great. Okay.
Yeah.
So just at the moment we do this step here, we just get to absorb this factor into it. Like the point is that the definition of G is this guy times that stuff.
Oh,
there.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, this is slightly backwards from what's in the notes. I am using the inverse Fourier transform with the notes use the forward Fourier transform. But okay, yeah. And the point is I get to remove that at that point when I go into the G. And so then I get to remove that, and then I get to remove that 3, and I'm a bit happier. Okay, good. Thanks. Okay, and now let's just continue down on this line. I can, again by the dominated convergence theorem, move the limit inside. The reason you can use the dominated convergence theorem is just that if you look at this integrand, that's certainly just less than the supremum norm of phi. Remember, phi is short, so like in particular it's bounded times this guy, okay, which is an L1 function. So you can use the dominated convergence theorem, even though the limit is sort of translating this function along sideways, because you're just using this absolute bound on the function anyway. That's okay. And that then is great, because you now just take this pointwise limit. That term disappears. This function no longer depends on what we're integrating over, so that just pops out, and we get phi of x, 2 pi, negative n over 2, integral here, and then by the magic of Gaussian integrals, those numeric factors cancel out. Okay, so there's lots of details there, but maybe the two things to take away from it are you perhaps should think carefully about whether you can justify those steps there. That's a good reminder of skills hopefully first seen in analysis too. But then the sort of interesting new technique that maybe you haven't seen before is this idea of inserting those sort of mollifying factors to let you use Fibini when otherwise you wouldn't be able to do it. Okay, let's press onwards. So I wanted to talk briefly about convolution, mostly because, there's some nice relationship between convolution and Fourier transforms, but mostly it's just a technical tool for now, at least, improving this next step. Have people seen convolution? I guess we had an example on the problem set, things like that. So people have probably seen at least the formula. Let's just write it. Make a few observations. Okay. A very first observation, which is maybe not instantly obvious from the formula, is that it's a commutative operation. F convolve G is equal to G convolve F. And it might look like you're sort of privileging F here, you're putting the difference of the variables in there and the other variable in there. But of course, just by a change of variables, you can switch that around. And come to here. And one reason why convolution is interesting is the following fact. So that an integral operator, so that is, these operators given by integrating against some kernel function which are translation invariant. So let me write a slightly fancy way of saying what translation invariant means. So here I'm thinking of T subscript A. I think we use the same notation another time. This is the operator that takes a function and translates it by A, by just adding A to the argument. And this is saying that K is translation invariant. It's saying that you can either take a function and translate it and then apply the operator K, or you can apply the operator K and then translate it. Okay. So integral operators which are translation invariant have kernel L, which is just a function of x minus y. I mean, basically you plug this definition into that formula and see that L can only depend on the difference of function x minus y, which can just depend on the vector between those two points, not the individual x's and y's. But if this is secretly just a function of one variable, and in particular of the form x minus y, that means it's convolution, and thus convolution with some fixed function, i.e. k is the function that is the operator that takes f to f convolved with L of blank comma zero. So maybe that just makes it more confusing. But like, if you extract that function of one variable, maybe I should write it like this. If L of xy equals M of x minus y, then I could have just written this as F convolved. Okay, but of course, if L is of this form, then you can, then M of x equals, which is why I was writing what I did a moment ago. Okay, so translation invariant integral operators are just convolution. Okay, all very well, but the thing that we want convolution for the next little while is that it's a really nice trick for smoothing functions, taking something non-smooth and producing something smooth out. So for this we need a bump function. So what do I mean by a bump function?
Delta.
That sounds awfully specific. I mean, when people say a bump function, they would usually just mean that it's compactly supported. They don't really care where, but supported on some little interval. And importantly, you want to have values in the interval 0 to 1, so you don't want the function getting too big or too small. And smooth, very importantly, you want your bump functions to be smooth. People often say a bump function is unit mass. That's just saying the integral of phi is 1. Okay, so they exist, and it's a little bit of effort to see that they exist. What's the trick to construct bump functions? So the problem is we've got to have something that's constantly zero out here, and then smoothly interpolates. And the problem is that a function like this can't be analytic, equal to its Taylor series, because then it would be equal to zero everywhere. So we need to admit the existence of smooth but non-analytic functions. But you can use by patching together some pieces modeled on functions like that. This is a function that vanishes at zero, and all its derivatives vanish at zero as well, so you can paste it together. Have you guys seen this? No? Okay. Read about bump functions if you haven't. And actually construct them. Write down a piecewise formula like f of x equals this function on this interval and this function on this interval, and convince yourself they really do exist. It's slightly subtle because they don't exist in the analytic world. Okay. So the theorem about smoothing here is that C infinity functions are dense in L1 functions, and in particular, if phi is a unit mass bump function, and we define phi subscript delta of x by this. Let's work in Rn actually. There's no cost to do this in Rn as well. We just need a delta to the minus n there. So what did I do by this little transformation here? I scaled the argument and I also scaled the heights. So as delta becomes very small, this has the effect of making phi delta supported on a smaller and smaller interval. Okay, our original phi was supported here, phi delta is becoming narrower. It's also becoming bigger as delta gets small. And this fact is here picked exactly so that it stays unit mass. Okay, it's growing at the right pace as it shrinks. Okay, so we defined that. Then you can just take f, some arbitrary L1 function, convolve it with phi delta, and this converges to f in the L1 sense. This guy is smooth. Okay, so not only are we proving that it's dense, we're showing a particular way to find an approximating sequence of smooth functions. So let's unpack that statement a little bit.
Scott, sorry, Jeremy. Yeah. Do bump functions have to be non-negative?
Nearly always people are going to want this condition here. Oh, sorry, values 0, 1, that's ridiculous, that's going to obviously fail. I should have just said non-negative. Thank you. That was a very grown-up mathematician way of saying, Scott, you're wrong! If you go to math talks and listen to people give talks and people in the audience, no one will ever, unlike in physics, stand up and saying, this is crap, like, that chart obviously shows that you had your electrodes plugged in backwards because it's all rubbish. I'll say, like, what happens in this particular case? And, like, you'll realize 5 minutes later they were pointing out that the theorem unravels. But
asking a polite question about something like that. But, yeah.
If you ever hear someone ask a question like, I don't, like, have you seen so-and-so's result in such and such a paper? It always means, like, everything you've said today is like a tiny subset of what was proved in the 1950s. It's never a, you might want to look at work. Anyway. Okay, so, we will prove this theorem, but we'll actually, in a moment, prove something even better. I mean, remember we said our obligation was to prove that Schwartz functions were dense in LQ, which is obviously much stronger, okay? Schwartz functions are even a subset of these guys, and we're saying we can do it for any Q, not just one. So we're not going to bother proving this theorem separately. It'll just be a special case. But maybe the one thing we should point out is why this is smooth. So why is that smooth? Is you write this guy as I guess I'm implicitly using I use the commutativity of the convolution here. I arrange it so that in the convolution the x variable here is appearing in the bump function rather than in the f. Okay? So now if I attempt to differentiate this, I have to argue that I can differentiate under the integral, but that's going to be fine because phi delta is as nice as you could possibly want, and the integrand is otherwise in L1. So differentiating under the integral will work here, and then all the derivatives hit this factor, which was smooth, so all those derivatives exist, and it doesn't matter how crappy f was. Now the way you should think of what this convolution is doing is you've got this crazy pretty good at drawing non-smooth functions, even discontinuous, whatever, function here. Now, when you do this convolution, what's it doing? Well, it's replacing it with a sort of, well, a smoothed out version of it. And the reason is just that the value of this convolution function at any point, you should think of as being like an average of the values of this function over a little interval nearby, where that little interval, the size of that little interval is controlled by the size of delta. I mean, that's what this convolution formula basically means. It's like a weighted average of values of f weighted by the value of phi sub d. And so you should expect that smooth, maybe, because as I move this point a little bit here, I'm just ever so slightly changing the set over which I'm averaging. So hopefully things can't change too badly because this bump function is dying off. So at the edges of the region I'm averaging over, there was only a very small contribution to begin with. And the reason it should converge to the original function is just that if you're averaging over a very, very tiny interval, hopefully you're just seeing the value at that interval anyway, the value at that point anyway. But anyway, we'll prove that carefully later. Now, yes, let's prove it now. Okay, so let's prove the big theorem, which is that Schwartz functions are dense in LQRN. We do this in cases. We first do the q equals 1 case, even though that's not the case we're really after. Q equals 2 is the case we're really after, but the point is that all of the other q's will be an easy consequence of the q equals 1 case. Okay. So, recall, it's always a dangerous word in maths lectures, this guy, so here I mean compactly supported, that's what the subscript C means, continuous functions are dense in L1. And hopefully that's something that you remember seeing in analysis too. Great. Okay, so we just need to show that the Schwartz functions are dense in the L1 norm
in these compactly supported continuous functions.
Okay, like if you've got one set that's dense in another set because dense in another set, your smallest set is dense in the biggest set. Denseness is transitive. Okay.
So, take some h in the compactly supported continuous functions. And now we're just going to prove basically the sort of corresponding fact over here that if we take h delta, define that to be h confold with phi delta, and that converges in L1, in the L1 topology, to h. Okay. So let's start. Do people understand the structure so far?
Okay. Is phi delta just a bump function?
Yeah, phi is just any old bump function, unit mass. Okay, so the first step is to see that h delta is still compactly supported. Okay, basically the idea is that both of these things are compactly supported, and so their convolution is compactly supported too. Like the value of this at some far out point is some like weighted average, weighted by phi of nearby values of h, and if you're far outside the support of h, that's just going to be an integral of zero everywhere. Okay. So, and moreover, actually, you could even say that the supports are shrinking. As delta goes to zero, you're convolving with narrower and narrower functions, so the supports are shrinking. So suppose h delta is supported on A, delta less than 1. Obviously, for really big delta, that's the direction you don't care about, the supports could be big. Okay. Then, let's observe as we introduce A, let's observe that it's still compact. Okay? I mean, did people see the detail of the argument here? Like, if phi delta is support on a ball of radius r, and h is support on a ball of radius r prime, the convolution is support on a ball of radius r plus r prime. So then h is uniformly continuous. On the A that we're interested in. And using that, we can get the estimates that we want. Okay. So pick delta. So h of x minus h delta of x. Getting ahead of myself. H of x minus h of y is less than some epsilon divided by the volume of this set A. Okay? So that's something we can, whenever x and y are within distance delta. Okay, that's just the meaning of being uniformly continuous, that we can do that. Okay. And so then we can calculate like this. We look at h of x minus h delta of x. Okay, so this is the quantity that we want to eventually integrate and show is small. Okay. So that's bounded by the following. So let's do it in two steps. It's a bit clearer. So I'll integrate over this little ball. H of x minus h of x minus z times v delta of z. Absolutely. So what's going on here? If I look at this term, okay, the h of x doesn't even interact with the integral. The h of x just pulls out, and we're just integrating the bump function. The bump function has unit mass. So that whole integral with just looking at that term just gives us h of x. The integral just disappears. When we're looking at just this term instead, well, that this formula here is exactly the formula for the convolution of h with v. So that whole integral is that guy. And so then we can bound this, bring the absolute value signs inside, use the fact that v is non-negative, and then use the fact that that h is not varying very much. Z is in this little unit ball. Z is in this little unit ball, so the arguments of the two h's here are close together, so we're allowed to apply that. And so we end up with There was a little problem in this line that maybe I skated over a little bit. I said here that the integral here, this is something I wasn't clear enough about, that this was just h of x. And I said the explanation for that was just that the h of x pulls out and then we're integrating the bump function. But here I'm that assumes that the bump is actually supported in this, the size delta bump is supported in this ball. So it should technically have really said at the beginning, take a bump function that's supported in the unit ball. Whereas when I first introduced bump functions, I just said some compact set. But now we can use this estimate up here, and this gives us that this is controlled by epsilon divided by the volume of A times 1. Because after we've controlled this by a constant, we're just integrating the bump function. And so that then tells us that the integral, that is the L1 norm of h minus h delta, which is just the integral of that, is bounded by epsilon. Because all of these functions here are supported in A, so this integral over all of Rn is the same as the integral over just the over just A. So that integral turns into epsilon, another factor of the volume. And that did it, okay? And even better, like it sort of told us how to pick your delta. It's exactly the delta that gives you, that you get from uniform convolution. Okay, great. Let's now do the second part. So somehow the second part feels really, really cheap to me. Like it's cheap. Something like we're getting. It really feels like we get something by nothing in this argument. So it's a bit surprising. So. Again, like in the previous one, we remembered that compactly supported continuous functions were dense in L1, and so just shown that Schwarz functions were dense in compactly supported continuous functions. Now we're going to do the same sort of two-step argument. So compactly supported bounded functions are dense in L3. I'm not sure, maybe this is something that would have been done in analysis too, but the proof is pretty easy. So just let E subscript n be the set of all x where nothing is too horrible. X is neither too big, nor is the value of f of x too big. Okay? And then you can easily see that F times chi en, so we're going to take the characteristic function on this set, is bounded, B
because it's zero unless f is except in the places where f is at most n, and compactly supported, because this En is inside the ball of radius n, and then it converges converges pointwise to f. What else? Do we just need to monitor? we can't quite use monotone because we're not assuming anything about the sine of f here. But we can say then that f chi e n converges in Q norm to f by the dominated convergence theorem, and the point just being that if you look at the integral we're doing here. Is certainly just less than this. So we're just multiplying by a function that's either 0 or 1. And that was f to the q is integrable. So you can use the dominated convergence theorem. Okay, so we get this fact. And so we need to show Schwarz functions are dense. Compactly supported, bounded functions. Okay, so let's just take some function of that in that set and see how we can get what we want. Say f supported on some big ball of radius r, and f never gets bigger than some m. Okay, something in that set. Well, then pretty easily, f is in L1, and then we can take g to be f convolved phi delta for sufficiently small delta so that in L1 norm g minus f is less than epsilon. Okay. So notice I'm not just saying here I could have said this. Could I have just said take G some Schwarz function within epsilon of f in L1 norm? I probably could have at this point. Like I've told you which particular g I wanted to take using the argument from the first half of the theorem, but I could have just said, I think, just take g in the Schwarz functions, which is what we proved you could do in the first half. Yeah, I think maybe it's just clearer to say it that way. You don't even need to mention convolution again at this point. Maybe I'll regret that and unerase that in a moment. Okay. I'm going to regret that at the very first step. Okay, but you'll see why we can't be sneaking out. So the next step that I need we want to know G is we want to know G is bounded by some quantity. Well, we've already introduced. I mean, certainly G is a bounded function because it's a Schwarz function. Okay, it's smooth and decays at infinity. So let's just continue, and we'll hope we might see what goes wrong. So say say we've just got G is bounded by M prime. Okay. Then, I mean, in a moment, I think we're going to see that we needed to work a bit harder to get a better bound. But let's do this calculation now. So if we look at the LQ norm of F minus G, and it's going to be easy to compute the Q's power of that, because this is just this integral, F of X minus G of X over Q dx. And now, I can use the fact that I know that F and G are both bounded functions. Yeah? F was bounded there and G was bounded here. So I can pull out Q minus one of those factors. And just, we bound them by their supernorm, times F minus G. And then you just have the L1 norm if you'd already pulled out all the remaining factors. And so then what would this be? You could then bound this by m plus m prime all to the q minus 1, and then by construction of g, this was less than epsilon. Okay, so that looks good. It says that, the q norm of f minus g is at most m plus m prime to the, what is it, q minus 1 over q, epsilon to the 1 over q. Now, does this actually get us there or not? I think that it doesn't. So what are we really meant to be doing? So we need given some epsilon. Since I've already used an epsilon here, and we might need to use a different one, let me just put epsilon tilde. So given epsilon tilde, a function g, so f minus g, and q norm, is within epsilon, so g is within epsilon tilde of f. That's the thing we're trying to prove. Okay? Does this construction actually do it for us? So the question is, like, once I've specified an epsilon tilde, can I pick an epsilon so that this makes things work? Yeah. But
m dash depends on epsilon.
Yes.
Right. So you could have, if you're trying to make epsilon small, you could have m dash blow up.
Yeah, exactly. The m dash here could depend on which g we picked here. Okay? And so that's why we've got to do this thing that I couldn't remember why I wanted to do it first. So let's not just take some arbitrary one using the first half of the theorem. Let's take g equal to f convolved with phi delta, for delta sufficiently small, so that holds. Okay, because now we can do much better. If we define our g by this convolution trick, the point is we can take this m prime and just write an m instead. Okay. Or very unhelpfully, just erase the m. Maybe erase the prime. Okay. The point is just here that a value of g, remember, is just some weighted average of values of f over some little ball nearby the point we're looking at. But if all the values of f are smaller than m, some weighted average of those values of f are also bounded by m. So we can save ourselves by saying, actually, that's bounded by the same m. And now we just get m plus m, or just 2m here. And now we're good. So now we can say, yes, just take epsilon. So epsilon tilde equals 2m the q minus blah, 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 blah. so on, and given whatever epsilon you like, given any epsilon tilde you like, work out what the epsilon should be. So everything comes out. But do people see there was a kind of subtle and horrible issue if we just picked an arbitrary G in Schwartz that did this? It's kind of a difficult thing. Okay. I think that brings us to the end of time, as well as the end of what I wanted to say today, for once, which is amazing. Okay, see you all on Monday. We can talk some more about the assignment then. If you haven't already spent substantial time thinking about the assignment, it's too late! No, that's what this weekend is for. Great, okay, see you then. Okay. I will continue recording.
Yeah, I guess you're not really doing anything.
No, so there's not really much to record there. I'll continue posting the solutions to things when we've done the videos, but yeah.